Good morning.
Good morning.
Please bow your heads with me for an opening prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you today. We are so grateful for all the blessings that you give us each and every day. And we know that we can rely on you, we can trust in you, and we can give you all the concerns and worries of our hearts. We can give you all the praise and adoration. Lord, you are just amazing. I am so grateful that we can come together and we can worship you and praise you and give thanks to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
If you could please stand and join me in the responsive reading found in your bulletin. I will sing to the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously.
The horse
and the rider is thrown into the sea. The Lord is my strength and my song, and he has become my salvation. This is my God, and I will praise him, my Father's God, and I will exalt him. When I am afraid, I will put my trust in thee. In God, those word I praise, in God I trust without fear. What flesh can do to me? My grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. Amen. Please take a moment and greet one another.
Good morning. Probably wonder what's in the bag, huh? Well, you know what? I brought you something. I hope you're excited as I am. It's probably, since it's just you two or three or four, it's more for us, so. I know all of us has been sitting there wondering what's in the bag, so. Well, let's see what we have here. I have SpaghettiOs. All right. Chef Boyardee. Cheetos mac and cheese. Flamin' hot. Cheetos? Regular? Can of dog food. That's all right. You know what? It's got beef and it's got cheese in it. But that's all right. If you don't like that, I got dog food with chicken in it. What do you think of that? Oh, I don't know. They're kind of giving me bad looks there. So. You want to feed that to your dogs? All right, all right. Well, I'm reminded of throughout the New Testament, we find that Jesus was followed by a lot of people. And some days he had hundreds, and some days he had thousands of people follow him. And they loved Jesus. And they loved him for his wisdom, his knowledge. He was full of information. And a lot of the people that surrounded him, a lot of them were teachers. And you ever said something to somebody who... Four? All right, there she is. All right, four, five, six, all right. Guess what, guys? I brought you lunch. Six cans of lunch, six kids. All right, this is great. Yeah. We are. I wasn't lying. So, you ever said something to somebody and they took it the wrong way? Even though you knew you were right, they got mad at you? You couldn't understand why? Well, this is what happened. John chapter 6, Jesus said something. He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. I am the bread of life. And you know what happened? A lot of people got mad about that. They were so upset that the Bible says that many walked away from him and they didn't follow him anymore. He turned to his disciples and he said, will you also walk away? And the apostle Peter said, Lord, where shall we go? Well, kids, I'm here to stand before you and tell you that those same people that walked away from Jesus, they're still around today. And they're here to tell you that there is no such thing as absolute truth, that truth is whatever you want it to be. And you know what we call that? We call that dog food, mixed with beef, chicken, and all sorts of magical flavors. See, there are people out there, there are teachers and chaplains out there that will tell you that Jesus wasn't really the Son of God. He was just a man. He didn't die for you. He wasn't buried and rose again 3 days later. None of that ever happened. There are people out there who will tell you that creation, in the way that you were taught, didn't really happen. There was no God who created. There was no intelligent designer. That the world just happened over a period of millions of years, or there was no such thing as Noah's Ark. When in fact, that there are over 300 stories throughout Africa and Asia that teach that there was actually a flood, and there was a boat that saved animals and a family, typically the number of eight. And there's evidence all over the world that point to a creator. Isn't that awesome? And you know what? They will tell you that all these things never happen. You know, studies show that a human consumption of dog food over a period of time will result in sickness and pain and ultimately death over a period of time. They will tell you that you can't know for sure that you're going to heaven, or there is no heaven, there's no place, or you can't, or that only a certain number will go to heaven. This is all called dog food. You ask me, why do they teach that? Why do they do that for? Well, the Apostle Paul ran into these same people throughout his time, and he was a very well-educated person, and he always debated them all the time. And he says in 2 Timothy chapter 3 that they are ever learned, never able to come to the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. Meaning that they think they are so smart, that they are willfully ignorant of the truth. They will tell you that you could pray to saints in the Bible and that they can make your petitions to God, or that you could burn all the Bibles in the world and that there's only one universally recognized person who can speak to God. And you know what? This is all dog food. mixed with beef, chicken, and all sorts of magical flavors, because the Bible says that Jesus Christ is the mediator between God and man. There, even some churches have come to the point where they just teach New Age Eastern Hinduism meditations, and now we have a big movement across America called the Church of Satan, where if you go inside, they have the crosses upside down, and they have a seat in the front of the church with a seat for Lucifer. This is all dog food. But I got good news for you kids, and the good news is this, is that here at First Baptist Church, you have pastors Ross and his wife Jennifer who love you and they care about you. And you have parents here in Sunday school, teachers who want the very best for you. And they will teach you truth. And the truth is this, that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. He did die for you. And you can know for sure you are going to heaven. And you can have that opportunity to accept Jesus Christ as your Savior. And he could fight the battles for you throughout all your life. And he can win your victories for you if you only allow him to. And so that's the good food in life. And that will keep you strong and healthy, and that'll keep you going. Who wants the SpaghettiOs? All right, come and get it. SpaghettiOs. Right. Come on. We got Chef Boyardee. Anybody like Flamin' Hot Cheetos? All right, Flamin' Hot Cheetos. There you go. Yeah. All right. Thank you.
Okay, who would like to pray? There you are, sweetie. Stand up. Thank you. Okay, go ahead.
Thank you, Lord Jesus Christ, for this lovely day. Thank you for everybody at the church, everybody you made. Thank you for the food, the water, and the shelter. Thank you for everything you gave us, the grass, the trees, the fruit, and the life. Jesus Christ.
Amen. Okay. We'll continue our worship. Awesome.
Though the tears may fall, my song will rise. My song will rise to you. Though my heart may fail, my song will rise. My song will rise to you. Water's right, I'll lift my
history of your love, looking for a place to alight on human hearts. And we can sing of what is, that you have made us the temple of your Spirit, and our heart as it were the Holy of Holies. Thank you, Lord, that to find you, we don't have to go somewhere or be at a certain time or be at a certain place. We look in to where you dwell within us in awe and wonder that the majesty of the Creator lives within us. And we can look, Lord, to what is coming and what is ahead as we step out and carry your presence in a new picture of the Ark of the Covenant, that we carry your presence, we carry and show the picture of your mercy. So thank you, Lord, that you have crowned us with the glory and honor that is yours. It's not sharing with another because we're yours. So we thank you today for the great mystery of what it means to walk with the one who made everything. And we thank you for it, Lord. In the name of Jesus, amen. You may be seated and the children can go to Sunday school.
If you have a Bible with you, please turn with me to Matthew chapter 11, verses 27 through 30. I want to say a quick thank you, an awesome thank you, not just a quick one, to all the fellowship team for providing all of the stuff for our reception for Joe's service. Thank you very much. Really appreciate it. It was wonderful. Thank you, Justin, for children's story. Thank you, choir. Those that are here for a wonderful Glory Lamb number and praise team. Matthew 20, 11, verses 27 through 30. While you're turning there, I'm going to read just a couple of verses out of 2 Chronicles chapter 20. When Jehoshaphat had a deep burden on his life, but he was reminded by the prophet, "Hearken, all Judah, inhabitants of Jerusalem, and King Jehoshaphat, thus says the Lord to you, fear not and be not dismayed at this great multitude, for the battle is not yours, but it's God's. The battle is not yours, it is God's." Matthew chapter 11, verses 27 through 30. "All things," Jesus said, "have been delivered to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son chooses to reveal him." Those are radical claims right there, right there. Jesus was already challenging the religious system of the day, and he said, no one knows the Father except me, and no one knows the Son except the Father. I and the Father are one, basically is what Jesus was saying. And then we come to these very familiar words, beginning at verse 28. "Come to me," Jesus said, "come to me. All you who labor and are heavy laden, I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." I want to talk this morning in this series on looking unto Jesus. I want to talk about anxiety doesn't have to win in our lives, however we define anxiety. It's a humorous, it's a sad, in my opinion, kind of a sad story about focus. That's what I'm really going to preach on today, is focus. Where's your focus? Where's my focus?
As pastors, we had to read a book called Leaders That Last, and the woman who wrote it is a consultant now, but she pastored a church in on the East Coast. She tells the story. If I can set this up right, she tells the story that it was Easter Sunday morning. Have I told you this story before? I'll get into it. If it rings a bell, maybe I told it 2 weeks ago. I don't know. She tells the story it was Easter Sunday morning. I know I shared it with at my workshop and with our board a couple months ago. That's what triggered me. Easter Sunday morning, she's pastor of the church. They're getting in line for a processional, the highest Sunday of the year, Easter Sunday. And she's leading a processional down the aisle to celebrate Jesus, to focus on the resurrection. Great. As she's standing, ready to come down the aisle, the chairman of the board taps her on the shoulder. Okay, must be an emergency. Must be really important. The chairman of the board said, "Pastor, did you know the men's toilet in the bathroom is leaking?" Easter Sunday morning at the beginning of the service, like that's really important. I get it. If there's a flood, we'll take care of it, but that wasn't the issue. And she writes about how she didn't let that person's anxiety affect her and take her off of the focus of why they were there on Sunday morning. And the chapter unveiled a series of great thought and great narrative about focus and anxiety that drives us. So in this passage, very familiar words of Jesus, "Come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. I'll give you focus." These words are so familiar, I think they just go over our head many times. And the words of Jesus, by the power of the Spirit, not just by the power of a preacher, but by the power of the Spirit, fail to inoculate our lives and give us a renewed focus every day. So what I want to do for this morning's message is I want to drill down on two phrases. I may enter a third phrase in there, because the phrase, "take my yoke upon you," is a great phrase. But I want to drill down on two phrases. And I want to start with the problem that Jesus was addressing to people of his day and to people of today, to you and I. First phrase I want to drill down on is this: all you who labor and are heavy laden. My first bullet point is this: be honest about your backpack. Be honest about what's in your backpack. So I've asked a volunteer to step forward and be willing to do this. So come on up, Brian. Come on up. We're going to put a backpack on you. And I want this to be a living illustration. I think this will fit you pretty good here. Yeah. It'll fit you pretty good. Now, it's pretty light. I mean, it's just pretty light, isn't it? So what we want to do is load you down, because we want to make you heavy laden. You're going to be a living illustration for all of us. So what did Jesus mean by "all you who are heavy laden"? What did he mean by that? Well, most scholars believe that he was addressing, first of all, the burden of the regulations of the law. The religious leaders of the day had instituted over 600 regulations that any follower of Yahweh had to keep. And you can see this in the Gospels, where Jesus healed somebody on the Sabbath, healed a man with a withered hand on the Sabbath. And they didn't like that. They didn't like it, not because the guy was healed, but because he did it on the Sabbath. You didn't do anything on the Sabbath. You didn't hardly get out of bed on the Sabbath. And on many occasions, Jesus said, which one of you, if you lose an animal in the watering trough, will not retrieve it? It's almost like Jesus, in our context, would say, which one of you wouldn't turn your car on to come to the synagogue service? That's how entrapped they were with the regulations and the law and trying to please God. Now, I know what you're thinking today. We're not under the law, Pastor. We're under grace. I get that. But I'm going to suggest something else is going on in our heads. We're under kind of a Christian ideal and perfectionism. And it goes something, this is one of the burdens, I think. I found this old tennis shoe, and so this is kind of the beginning of it. This isn't very heavy, but it's a burden that says, I could have done better. I could have done better. If I'm such a spirit-guided Christian, then how come I didn't respond to that person better? And then added to that is guilt and shame. I know I'm forgiven, but I'm walking around with a sense of guilt and a burden of shame, and I could have done better. We all have, I mean, you can push back on this, but we all have our Christian ideals. And I'm not saying they're bad, but they become burdens. They become kind of the law in our own spirit. I could have done better. I shouldn't have gotten mad. I should have loved that person. I should have prayed harder. Christian ideals and perfectionism. So that becomes kind of a burden. But that's not the only burden. There's another burden I think we deal with. A burden of others. I know the Bible says in Galatians 6:2 that we need to bear the burdens of one another. I get that. The burdens of others. You know? It goes something like this. If I would have just talked to them, they wouldn't be going down that. If I would have prayed harder, they wouldn't be making their bad choices in life. Burdens of others. Yeah, I feel for them, but it's that burden of others. And you know what? I resent that person, and I resent what they said. I'm mad at them. That becomes a burden you're carrying. Well, if that's not enough, that's not how you're feeling. We don't care. You're not my burden. Now, here's a good one. Here's a good one. Justin talked about the absolutes of theology. And by the way, we didn't coordinate anything here, did we? We didn't coordinate. He talked about the absolutes of theology. But you know what? Outside of the absolutes of theology are a lot of apparently paradoxical, I'll even hit upon one this morning, things in Scripture like, I don't know if I understand that. I introduced the sermon about a woman pastor. To some people, that's kind of a burden of theology, how to reconcile biblical thoughts. That can become a burden if you want to be biblical, and I know you do. That can become a burden. How do I reconcile thoughts, opinions, convictions? This verse says that verse says that. Of course, I suppose you could escape all that by saying, I don't even study the Bible. Which I hope you don't, but you reconcile biblical thoughts, and that can become kind of a burden. Bad burden, but it become a burden. I just threw that one in because a lot of people, well, what do you think about that, Pastor? What, that verse says that. That theological thing says that. I appreciated some comments I heard about Mary as I preached on Mary on Mother's Day. I didn't venerate her, but I think I honored her as the Theotokos, as the God-bearer. But some people might have felt like, that's getting a little edgy there. Well, a burden of theology, reconciling biblical thoughts. got life demands. How you doing? Okay, you're doing okay. Okay, well, we're going to really pull on some life demands here. Health issues. Health issues. That's a life demand. That's a burden. How come God didn't heal? I don't know if God's directing me. That's a life demand. Unresolved decisions. How many of us have unresolved decisions that are on the back burner of our life, and we haven't come to grips with that, and they kind of keep speaking to us once in a while? What are you going to do about that? What are you going to do about that? That becomes a burden. And then I know all of you sit around, especially in this nice weather, you sit around on your patio and drink iced tea and lemonade all the time, so I know you don't have a to-do list. I know you don't. The to-do list, I got to get that done. If I'm going to make life work for me, I got to get, and then you've got your work demand. I know some of you are retired, and so you're still working, but the life demands just become very heavy. How you doing? You're sweating a little bit, but that's okay. Wow, and you didn't think you were heavy laden and you were having a good morning until I talked about heavy ladenness. Unresolved decisions or issues, we all have them, and they become these burdens that we carry in a backpack. Now, my point was, 10 minutes ago, when was the last time you checked in your backpack and you, I think I'm carrying something here. Now, I'll tell you why this is so important. Here's what I want you to take notes on. This is why I think it's so important to look in your backpack once in a while and to think about, what am I carrying? Number one, here's why it's so important. Because we think it's normal. It's normal, right? It's normal that Jesus Christ would want me to carry this backpack around. Now, it may look pretty good to Brian to stand here and do this, but I don't think he wants to carry this around all day long. And we're about done with your part here. Okay, you okay? All right. It's getting heavy, isn't it? Don't say that. I wasn't part of the message here. You're supposed to say I can't handle it. We'll come to that in a moment. We think it's normal. I'm just carrying this around. It's got to be normal. Especially as everybody talks about their burdens to me. Must be normal. Here's the second why you need to examine your backpack. And I need to examine mine. We blame others for our rocks. Now, I'm not going to camp on this point very much, although I'm tempted to. If they wouldn't have done that, if they wouldn't have said that, I wouldn't be carrying this rock. What did I just do? I just blamed them. I'm carrying a burden. I've just blamed them. We blame others for our rocks. They made bad choices, and I'm bearing the burden for. That's really good theology. But the most important reason why we need to examine our backpack is this. The rocks become our focus, not Jesus. The rocks become our focus. I'm carrying this. I've got this in my life. I'm carrying this. And how do you know when the rocks become your focus and not Jesus Christ? I don't know. That's something every one of us has to discern. It might be what you talk about a lot. That could be a clue. Probably not the clue, but it could be a clue. Maybe it's what I started this message with. Easter Sunday morning, we're here to celebrate the risen Christ. No, my focus is on a leaky toilet in the bathroom. Maybe that's how you know. But that's what happens. So I know, I get it. We need to take the backpack off. Oh, how did you do that? Let's let's give Brian a hand. All right. We need to take the backpack off and put it at the feet of Jesus. Sermon's over. That's easy. I'm going to suggest to you this isn't easy. This ain't easy. I just made it sound easy. It's not easy. It's not as easy as you think. The second thing I want to drill down on this morning is exactly this. Look to Jesus. Come unto me. I'm going to give you three or four things of looking unto Jesus about focus. Here's what I want to avoid in this thing, because maybe I'm going to turn around and do the very thing I don't want to do. I want to avoid the cliches. So that could be a good step. At least examine your cliches. All I do, Pastor, is just turn it over to the Lord. I think that's a cliche. Cliches are there because they've been codified. They have truth in them. But it's almost like how we use them is not with integrity. It's like we'd say to Jesus in Gethsemane, Jesus, just turn it over to the Father and get on with it. Have you ever examined this great hymn, What a Friend We Have in Jesus? And it is a great song. I sing it to him all the time. Are you burdened with a load of care? Have you taken everything to God in prayer? And the old spiritual, just a little talk with Jesus. All you need is 5 minutes with Jesus, and there goes your rocks. I'm going to suggest, because we live with cliches, we don't go deeper into this phrase of what it means to really look at Jesus and that he becomes our focus. So saying that, I want to give you three or four things, not a formula. These are three or four things that I think will help in looking unto Jesus and coming unto him. By the way, this phrase isn't just about saying a simple prayer and getting saved. It begins there. But throughout life, and even this week, we pick up all the rocks. So, what does it mean to come unto Jesus, come unto me? I'm going to suggest some things I think will be helpful that goes a little deeper than just the pattern cliche of life. Number one, I think you have to adopt this in your heart. I seek you and I long for you. I mean, if I'm going to go deeper about this phrase, what does it mean to come unto Jesus? I've got to start with this, my heart attitude. I seek you and long for you. I just don't pray a 30-second prayer. God, direct me during this day. I seek you and I long for you. Psalm 16:11 says, in your presence is fullness of joy. Matthew 6:33, seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all the things will be added unto you. John 15:1 says, abide in me as I abide in you. Now, here's my suggestion. I want to be careful I don't develop another legalism, another Christian perfectionism. But I'm going to make this suggestion. You have to take time in the presence of the Lord every day to get your focus on him. It does not come magical. There's somebody called our enemy, the devil, that wants you to focus on leaky toilets, not the power of the resurrected Christ. Do I hear an amen? You have to take the time. Now, this is what will sound legalistic. You have to get away from Facebook. You have to get away from TV. You have to get away from your phones. You have to get away to whatever garners your emotional and spiritual strength. I'm not saying that stuff is bad, but you have to get away from it to focus in the presence of the Lord. You know, one of the interesting things of walking with Christ, we have to take the time like it's enjoyable. Many of you hunt and fish. I try to fish, but I'm very good. Many of you hunt and fish. You'll spend hours doing that. That's wonderful. You enjoy that. Many of you are into quilting, baking. I'm into pancakes myself, and man, Denny's has been trying to recruit me. I'm teasing, are you kidding me? You do enjoyable things because you enjoy them. How come we do not take the time in enjoyment of the Savior like we do other things? Well, it's different, Pastor. I don't think it is. I don't think it is. Come unto me is a phrase that speaks to me about I want to enjoy my Jesus more than my rocks. I want to be captivated by his grace, his love, his majesty. So I'm just preaching to myself because enjoying our Savior should be quite enjoyable. Not just a category. When we were visiting Jasmine, husband Abel in Virginia, we went to Williamsburg. It's a historical site. We went to, and you can spend literally hours or days at Colonial Williamsburg. Costs a lot, so you want to get your money's worth during the day. You just walk in different places and shops and stores and whatever. I walked into a blacksmith's shop. And I got enthralled with their message and their focus. And they were describing what blacksmiths did in the colonial era and what how farmers needed implements, yet the army needed implements, and the pressure was on the blacksmiths to produce. I mean, I could have been in that blacksmith shop amidst the smoke and the grease for an hour, just listening. Wow. But two other young ladies were saying, we gotta go. It was all great fun. I'm trying to give you a picture of your focus. What has your focus really been? Remember, my rocks can become my joy because it's normal rather than Jesus Christ. Second thing that really works for me. Now, Brian never said that, and I never coached him to say anything. That's okay. But it's this. No, I want to go back to that. I think that's very, very important of what it means to come to Christ. And I want to focus on you, Jesus, not what I'm against. I want to focus on the good news of the gospel, not what I'm against. And I think this is really important. I need to focus on you, not the chaos around me. Second thing that works in my life about coming to Christ and looking unto him is to say, I can't handle this. I can't handle that. I don't know if that works in your life. It works in my life. just trying to be honest. If I'm going around, now again, I'm not criticizing you, Brian, but if I go around and say, it's okay, you know what I think Jesus does? He says, okay. He'll leave you alone. But when you say, I can't handle this anymore, he's going, hallelujah. And he's saying to you, I know you can't handle it. I find this so freeing. Because when I say to Jesus almost every day, I can't handle this, he shows me what to do with the rocks. He shows me how to pray through each of those rocks. He shows me what to say, how to lift them privately to him. And here's what I truly believe. The admission of the end of our strength, which is a huge admission. And here's the conundrum. Here's the biblical reconciling thought that I know how to reconcile it, but well, maybe some of you don't. I don't know, because I think it's a conundrum. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Go out and get them. I can do all things. I get it. But it's only when I admit I can't handle this that his strength becomes power in my weakness. Do I hear you now? So the admission of the end of our strength is the beginning of his strength. The admission of the end of our strength becomes the beginning of his strength. This is not a one-time event. As if you go to a conference and you unload your rocks and you wait for the next conference to come along. This has got to be an everyday event. I can't handle this. That works in my life. I'm just suggesting it might be of help. That how do you really focus on him and come to him? I'm going to suggest it's in that phrase. It's in that admission. I can't handle this. That's when you open yourself up to the leading of the Holy Spirit. And you open yourself up and he shows you what to do. And things will come to you like never before about what to do. Number three, here's what works in my life. You fight my battles. You fight my battles. I am exalting you, Lord. If I'm going to come to you and if I'm going to focus on you, I'm going to declare you fight my battles. Have we forgotten this truth? Have we forgotten this glorious biblical truth? You are my warrior God, and you fight my battles. And I love that song that's out there, though I can never remember the name of the singer or the title of the song. I fight my battles on my knees, and my weapon is a melody. You fight my battles. 2 Chronicles 20:15. Jehoshaphat didn't know what to do. He was a godly king. He didn't know what to do. And the prophet Jehaziel comes to him and to everybody and says, you will not fight today. The battle is not yours. It is the Lord's. When was the last time that you came to Jesus on a daily basis and said, I can't fight this battle. I can't fight it. The battle is yours. That's what it means to come to Jesus on a daily basis. You fight my battle. Doesn't mean I don't have responsibility, I don't pray, I don't make decisions, but you're the one who fights my battle. You know why this is so important? Because most of the rocks are situations out of our control. The burdens that we carry, that we're not to carry, are usually out of our control anyway. And secondly, some of the rocks are people we can't control. They are burdens that are out of our control. And some of the rocks on our backpack represent people and their free will and their choices that we cannot control. So Jesus Christ, you fight my battles. Your way, your time. I wanted a great story about somebody who carries the game. You remember Stacy King? He was a longtime NBA player. Kind of a comedian. really good player in his own right, but he was asked what was the greatest game of his NBA career. He said it was the game where Michael Jordan and I scored 71 points. Wow. You and Michael Jordan scored 71 points. Yeah, he said, he told the announcer, he said, I was Michael Jordan's backup, and I got into the last 2 minutes of the game. Michael Jordan had already scored 69 points, and I got into the game and made two free throws, so Michael Jordan and I scored 71 points. I think Michael Jordan carried the game. My little 2 points made me feel good. See, that's the vision you need to have. If I'm going to come to Jesus, it's just not a statement about my theology. I've accepted Christ and going to heaven. It's a statement, he fights my battles. He fights every one of those rocks that I'm carrying in my backpack. Now, I'm going to finish with this one. Because it really helps me to say, I exalt you that you fight my battles. But the fourth thing I want to give to you today is something we always need to say to Jesus, because Jesus said this in this passage. Take my yoke upon you. My yoke is easy and my burden is light. You've almost got to say, Jesus, instead of the rocks, give me your yoke. What on earth does that mean? That's a good question. It's become so familiar, I don't think we ever explore. What does it mean to say, Jesus Christ, give me your yoke? A little background. That's what a yoke would have looked like in the day. Since we don't use those anymore, that's what it would have looked like. Oxen plowed the ground and they were yoked together. Now, doing a little research on this, some believe, this is very interesting, just doing research on the yoke of the day. Some believe that farmers of Jesus' day, that's what the oxen would have looked like in a yoke. And some believe that many farmers would have a younger, inexperienced oxen paired with an older, stronger oxen. Makes sense. And so the older, more experienced, beefier oxen was the bigger animal. And one preacher got into that. I watched him on YouTube. And he got into that Jesus is our bigger animal. That's amen. That's good stuff. One scholar suggested that the reason why Jesus used this image of the yoke is because as a carpenter, Jesus probably made hundreds of yokes for people. Makes sense. Farmers, according to one scholar, would bring their oxen, they would have a yoke made, but they would bring the oxen into the carpentry shop, and the carpenter would tailor fit the yoke to the oxen. I thought that was insightful. So that the yoke was not too tight and choking, and the yoke was not too loose. That wouldn't guide the oxen. So why on earth did Jesus say, take my yoke upon you and learn from me? I'm not going to answer all of that because it takes too much time, and I'm not sure I have all the answers to that. But I'm going to suggest a couple. You have to ask Jesus for his yoke in your life instead of the rocks. Now, what could that mean? I think number one, give me your yoke at this season of my life. I think you have to be honest and sincere with Jesus. Give me your yoke. I've been carrying a backpack full of rocks. I want your yoke at this season of my life. You know, we're all called to do certain things, and I think that when Jesus said my yoke is easy, it means I have a calling on your life. You have responsibilities, you do have cares, but make sure it's my yoke. give me your yoke at this season of my life. I think that's so appropriate to go before the Lord and say, I want your yoke. But here's the second thing that I believe it means in my life anyway. Give me the discernment between a rock and your yoke. Amen. Because I think we pick up rocks that he doesn't want us to pick up. Oh yes, the Lord just put that on my heart. I don't know that. You have to discern it for yourself. The difference between a rock that you put in your backpack and his yoke. How do you know? Well, Jesus said, when you put my yoke upon you, you'll have rest for your soul. You'll have peace. You'll flow with things. It's tailor-made for you at this season of your life. I wish I could say this was a one-time event, that all the stuff would be solved at the end of a sermon or prayer time. I'm going to suggest to you it's not. We continually need to refocus. It's not a one-time transaction. You'll feel like you've gotten rid of your rocks and yes, I want his yoke, and you'll go down by Wednesday night. You might have picked up a couple of rocks that aren't his yoke for you. And you have to continually refocus. But there's a great promise in this passage. You will find rest for your souls. I want to leave you with that. You'll find rest for your souls. I'm going to suggest to you it's just not a physical rest. There's nothing wrong with that, by the way. Rest in your spirit. This is resolved. I'm at peace with it. So I'm going to end with the famous story I've told you before. Jennifer and Josh was in one of those little hand travel things. What do you call those? I've forgotten now that I'm a grandparent's age. We were in this little charter flight from way up north in Wisconsin down to Minneapolis, and I got so sick on that flight. It was an hour-long flight in a thunderstorm. That's all I remember. By the time we landed at Minneapolis to catch a flight to Portland, I was so sick. I just wanted to get to the nearest bathroom, which I don't even remember making that. I don't know how Jennifer had the strength. We got to catch our flight. And I had Joshua in one arm, and the other hand was on my stomach or mouth. I'm not sure, but we boarded that plane. And I'll never forget this, though. The pilot goes, "We'll soon be above the clouds and the turbulence." Music to my ears. I think I slept all the way to Portland. That's rest. But you know what? I don't care who you are. I don't care who I am. There's something that's going to happen in your life that'll make you spiritually and emotionally have vertigo. It'll make you sick. You'll pick up the leaky toilet stuff instead of focusing on Jesus Christ. That's why this is so continual. That's why you have to be really honest about what am I carrying in my backpack? Am I carrying other people's offenses, other people's stuff that's affecting me and my walk with the Savior? I hope this has been a help about looking to Jesus. Let's pray. Father, we just come before you because we know. We know that we have an enemy. We know that we have a sinful nature. We know that we don't walk perfect, and that's okay. But, Father, we know that we pick up rocks. We just pick up things. Sometimes we aren't even aware that we're picking up stuff. So help us to discern what's really in our backpack. Help us to discern that. Help us not just to live in our cliches. Help us to truly take the time with you that you're the delight of our soul. You're the captain of our fate. You're our redeemer, our healer. We look to you for life. we say this morning, we love you and we recommit this focus stuff to you. And maybe for some, it's saying, I can't handle this. I can't handle their stuff. I can't handle my stuff. Yay and amen. And maybe for some, it's saying, I will take your yoke upon me. I will discern the difference between the rock and the yoke and what's really important. Help us to do that, Jesus. Because every one of us will go through times of spiritual and emotional vertigo. And we'll get in turbulence and we'll wonder what's really important. So keep our focus on you. We just praise you for your grace, your hand that's stronger than our hand, your love that's stronger than our love, to keep our focus on you. We thank you. If anybody here, Jesus, does not know you as Lord and Savior, I want to pray that today they would come to you for the first time. They would say, I need Jesus Christ in my life. And then there's all of us, Lord, who have said that, but I need you, Jesus. I need you every hour. I need you to take this rock. And we just thank you we can do that right now. But we thank you we can do it every day. And we praise you for that. Your precious name, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Let's stand as we sing. Turn your eyes on Jesus. Thank you.